It was simpler. But we're not living in simple times anymore. I mean, I didn't come up in the age of YouTube. I'm actually pretty old, right? So this is a new phenomenon. I didn't come up in the age of Facebook or Twitter. You know, you being exposed to world cultures means that it doesn't matter if you're living in Bahrain or in Saudi or, you know, in Malaysia or anywhere else, we are almost becoming very quickly a global culture. You're exposed to things that my children are exposed to, that I'm exposed to. Our exposure is not much different. Maybe the way our environment around us physically looks is different, but the ideas and the temptations and the entertainment even that we are all being bombarded with is almost identical.
In the name of God, the extremely merciful, the constantly merciful, I find no greeting better than the universal expression of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The SayOneCare project team welcomes you and your families to the most awaited event of the year, the Youth Care Conference, which focuses on empowering the youth with a new series of lectures by world-renowned orator Ustadh Nouman Ali Khan, who came to visit us all the way from the United States. The Youth Care Conference is a brand new initiative with many development plans in the coming years. It was organized by the SayOneCare project team in Bahrain, which is a non-profit organization which aims to develop capacities for positive change, enhance the health and well-being of our society, and provide social support to our people. Our key areas of work include arranging practical training programs based on group work, offering free counseling and advocacy services, providing specialist support to other Islamic organizations, and building international partnerships. The SayOneCare project aims to serve our youth, our women, and the needy. However, we are paying special attention to the Youth Care Initiative, which is focused on exploring the dynamics of our youth. Since many of the issues our youth face today are also prevalent in other developed countries and communities across the world, we truly believe that if we can facilitate the empowerment of youth, we can, inshallah, make an exponential impact on all the important aspects of our society. Our youth will be tomorrow's leaders, and they are undoubtedly one of the critical areas of our society where we need to invest our time and resources. This year's Empower Youth event aims at addressing the role of friendships and responsibilities that our youth are brought up in. Their behavior and attitude is a product of what is going on in their homes, their communities, and their schools. The more we understand our socioeconomic and political context, the more effective we can be in serving our communities, which can be possible by facilitating constant reminders and good teachings that encourage us all to become productive rather than destructive. We are particularly privileged to have the youth group of the SayOneCare project as the major sponsors of this event. And we're especially grateful for the continued generosity of our commercial sponsors, Asghar Ali Perfumes and the Bukhua Group. We feel immensely proud and privileged to have this event under the patronage of His Excellency Sheikh Abdullah bin Khalid Al Khalifa, President of the Supreme Council of Islamic Affairs, and we cordially thank him for his consistent support to promote the development of the youth in Bahrain. We'd also like to thank Discover Islam and Al Fateh Mosque Management for their full support in making this event possible in this beautiful venue. It is truly a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be honored with having Ustadh Nouman Ali Khan here with us today. I'm sure most of you already are quite familiar with our beloved Ustadh, but I would like to give a brief introduction for those who don't know him yet. Ustadh Nouman Ali Khan is the founder and CEO of Bayyinah Institute, a leading Arabic and Quran studies institute based out of Texas. Throughout his study over the last 14 years, his YouTube lectures have continued to focus on insights, nuances, and the literary appreciation of the Quran. He's also in charge of a 9-month full-time Arabic and Quran studies program, the only one of its kind in the US. Finally, ever since performing Hajj last year, he has dedicated himself to building, inshallah, the most comprehensive Quran and Arabic video learning resource to date for families, adults, and children at Bayyinah TV. Before we begin, I'd like to remind you all to switch off your mobile phones and no food, please, in the musalla area. Without further ado, I'd like to welcome Ustadh Nouman to enlighten us on the very important topic of tonight's event, titled True Friends.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين ثم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وما أضلنا إلا المجرمون فما لنا من شافعين ولا صديق حميم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا اله الا الله اللهم اجعلنا من الذين امنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر امين يا رب العالمين. I know I can't see everyone here today, but even if you can't see me and I can't see you, first of all, a very near and dear assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh once again. And I want to express how honored I feel to be able to address all of you in this community. This has been a long-standing dream of mine to be able to visit the Muslim world and to meet with the youth and the communities wherever they may be. And Allah Azza wa Jal has opened these doors in a way that I couldn't have imagined. And so I'm extremely grateful to have the honor of meeting all of you. I don't think I'll be able to get to say salam to each of you individually, inshallah ta'ala. But regardless, know that I'm very grateful for your company tonight. And I start by asking Allah to make this gathering of ours of benefit to us here while we're here, and to accept it as an act of worship towards Him. And also that that the barakah and the good, the unexpected good that comes out of this gathering is good for our lives and our children and our futures, inshallah ta'ala. So it's a pretty big subject, friendship. And it's not something that I personally take lightly, because my own life story and my own journey towards Islam actually begins with friendship, at least my serious journey towards Islam. And I want to start today's talk with something personal that you might find easier to relate to, especially the younger audience here. And I want to also highlight the differences between when I was coming up and, you know, in the times that you guys are coming up. A lot of teenagers, I think, are in the audience, college students, people in their 20s. And especially today's talk is addressed towards you guys. I know we have elders in the audience also, and I think they'll find some things of benefit as well. But my primary concern are the young people in the audience today, and the young people that may be listening online. So my elementary education was actually in Saudi, in Riyadh. And I went to a Pakistan embassy school. I think it was called the International School eventually. And it was a schooling much like a lot of the kids here and a lot of the youth here, the kind of schooling they've gone through. It's very typical. And as a matter of fact, I had the opportunity to visit one of the schools today, and I had flashbacks. I thought I was traveling through time. And I almost stood up when I walked into the classroom, because the teacher walks in and you're supposed to stand up and stuff. So it's not something we do in America, but certainly something we do all over everywhere else, right? So it was really cool to be able to go and kind of visit. It really felt like visiting my own childhood. But what I want to highlight is it was a great, great experience to be able to have certain elements in the culture of that education. And those elements were things like a high level of respect for your teacher, and just really genuine friendships that weren't made up of some kind of agenda. And let me just highlight a difference. When we talk about friendships in America, like kids in high school that want to make friends, then, you know, it's really about whether they're dressed like you or not. So that the hip-hop kids are kind of in one culture, and the kids that are into heavy metal music are in a different kind of culture, and they hang out by themselves, and everybody's got their clique, right? Everybody's got to fit in into some kind of space. And you have to try to fit in with one of them. So it sounds like in America we don't have uniform in schools, but actually we do. You know, it depends on what kind of, you know, fashion you're into or what kind of genre you're into. You're going to fall in that category. I didn't feel that over when I was coming up. You could just playing around and like, hey, you want to play? Yeah, let's play. And it wasn't complicated. You didn't have to become socially acceptable before you became someone's friend. You know, it was simpler. It was simpler. But we're not living in simple times anymore. I mean, I didn't come up in the age of YouTube. I'm actually pretty old, right? So This is a new phenomenon. I didn't come up in the age of Facebook or Twitter. You know, you being exposed to world cultures means that it doesn't matter if you're living in Bahrain or in Saudi or, you know, in Malaysia or anywhere else, we are almost becoming very quickly a global culture. You're exposed to things that my children are exposed to, that I'm exposed to. Our exposure is not much different. Maybe the way our environment around us physically looks is different, but the ideas and the temptations and the entertainment even that we are all being bombarded with is almost identical. As a matter of fact, even the local version of entertainment is so much influenced by, you know, dominant media like Hollywood and things like that. So you're going to have like, we have American Idol, and I heard recently there's Arab Idol, for example, right? So you have, there's this infusion of one kind of culture. And with that comes some very serious challenges. And one of those challenges, in my personal opinion, is genuine friendship. It's very hard to make genuine friends anymore, because we're in the age of virtual friends. Like, how many friends do you have on Facebook? As a matter of fact, it's a pretty strong exaggeration to call those friends on Facebook. There's people that just clicked a button. That doesn't make them your friend, you know? Or they put a thumbs up or a thumbs down on one of your comments. That doesn't make them your friend. This is entirely virtual. But for a lot of people, that's all that matters. They can spend their entire day just clicking, 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 waiting for someone to approve their comment so they can feel better about themselves. And finally, once they get an okay, their life is worth living again or something, you know. It's pretty sad, but that's the reality for a lot of people. And there are reasons for that. And one of the reasons for that is that genuine friendships outside of a screen, other than here, friendships outside of here, have become harder to form. They become harder to make. You know, and especially the friends that we have outside of that, even they are pushing us back towards that virtual world, right? And it's some basic fundamentals that aren't even Islamic values. I'll talk to you about the Qur'an today and how the Qur'an talks about friends. But before I do, some basic things. You know, there are this human interaction for you and I to be able to have a 20-minute conversation without picking up our phone and checking an email, or checking an update, or checking somebody's tweet, or sending a tweet. I mean, I've been in lectures where the speaker tweeted while he was speaking, and I got an update, and I was like, how did he do that? That was awesome. You know? So we're so connected to our devices, and unfortunately, one of the things that's done is it's made us less connected to each other. We're not able to have real, genuine connections with each other, you know? And so my first advice to all of you is to detox a little bit. These things are really cool, but they've started to own us. We don't really have a life outside of them. You know how people that have asthma, they have to take an inhaler every few minutes? You know? And they have a problem in breathing? It's become like that for phones. You sit somewhere like, I need to, is there Wi-Fi in here? Is there, you know? You know? That's become us. It's pretty sad. SubhanAllah. So in any case, the other thing I wanted to highlight about myself personally is that if it wasn't for friends, if it wasn't for Allah Azza wa Jalla putting friends in my path, I don't even know if I would have been Muslim. I don't. Even though I was brought up here with Islamic values. But when I was exposed to and immersed in American culture and in a high school environment, I said astaghfirullah for the first month. Or 2 months, 6 months in, that was gone. I was completely immersed. It became okay, you know. I mean, some of you have heard my story about this on YouTube and stuff. I'll just give you a glimpse of it again. You know, when I went into high school the first day, guys and girls are sitting together in class, you know, and there's like hand over arm, and they're like, I've never seen it, you know. What is that? And then the way the girls were dressed. And then when you sit inside the class, there's no respect for the teacher. There's a kid sitting with his feet up on the table. The guy next to me is sitting with feet up on the other guy's like chewing gum. Oh, chewing gum is like the death penalty, man. In like an Islamic environment. You don't mess with the teacher. And if the teacher asks you a question over here, what do? You just sit there and go, yeah, I don't know. I'm not in the mood to answer you right now, Frank. You don't do, you get up and answer, Assalamu alaikum, sir. And the answer is 364.2 or something. Not in America. You don't even show respect to your teachers. You don't. And when that goes far enough, well, you start losing respect for all elders, including your parents. And when that goes far enough, you have respect for nothing else, including your own life, including yourself. You start losing respect all around. And I'm telling you, had it not been for really cool friends that I found by the mercy of Allah, by the rahmah of Allah, in college, not even in high school, had it not been for awesome friends, I don't know. And looking back, those are not friends that were super knowledgeable. They were not da'is. They were not giving me khutbas every time I sat down with them. They were not giving me long speeches and advice. They were not, my conversations with them were not filled with ayat and ahadith. It wasn't like that. Not at all, actually. And had they been like that, had they been very preachy and constantly giving me advice, I wouldn't have wanted to be their friend. I would have been like, this guy thinks he's the imam of a masjid or something, and I'm sitting in Jumu'ah every time I meet with him. I don't want to be anywhere near him. I don't need that. You know, I wasn't interested in that. Real friends are people that don't judge you, and they're not there to teach you. They're there to be for you first. They're not there to, you know, make sure you understand something, or make sure you get, you know, you listen to this lecture or watch this video. And that's the first thing I want everybody here to understand. We could have gone two ways in today's conversation. One of the ways is, what kind of friends should you look for? That's one kind of conversation. What kind of friends should you look for? But actually, that to me is also kind of selfish. I really want to talk to you today about what kind of friend should you be. Not about what kind of friends you should have, but what kind of friends you should be. And when you become the right kind of friend, then Allah will put the right kind of people in your path. And really, that's what it is. So the first thing I want to highlight today, inshallah ta'ala, is, you know, especially those of you that are religiously conscious, and the fact that you're in the masjid today, and you've come to this program, means you have some level of consciousness towards the deen, and you have some concern. And I'm pretty sure you have friends that are pretty far from the deen too. You have friends that aren't interested in praying five times a day. They're not interested in listening to Islamic lectures or, you know, seeking knowledge and all of this stuff. That doesn't interest them. You know, maybe on the 27th of Ramadan, maybe you'll find them in the masjid. If they're in a good mood, maybe an Eid prayer or something. You have those kinds of friends. They exist. Even here, it's a fact, you know. And they're into some really bad things. They have some really bad habits that you know about, and you don't tell anybody, but you know at least what they're up to. And that's a reality. But you know what? The first thing I want to tell you is, don't cut yourself off from those friends. Don't give up on them. They're also Muslim. Yes, they're very far. Yes, they're into all kinds of sin. But at the end of the day, they were given the gift of La ilaha illallah, even though they haven't come to appreciate it yet. Somebody was there for me that didn't give up on me. Somebody saw, I used to have a really bad mouth. If I talk like the way I used to, you would have to censor me out. Most of my sentences, you know what I'm saying? But I wasn't given a lecture about, hey, watch your mouth, hey, don't. Well, not even that, the guy was patient with me. And slowly he was like, hey, could you cut down on the, you know, my ears are starting to bleed. He'd just bring it up as a joke, and I'd be like, okay, sorry, man, sorry. Yeah, I gotta cut down. So you have to first be there for friends without being judgmental. That's really important. The easiest way to cut friends out of your life is to start acting like you're more righteous than they are, or you're more knowledgeable than they are. Or you need to help them and they are in need of your help, like you're in some position of superiority. And this is, by the way, a form of arrogance. And people see right through it. You think you're serving deen or doing amr bil ma'roof and nahi anil munkar, or you're doing da'wah fi sabilillah. You're not. That's not da'wah. That's just you acting like you are there to save someone else. That's not how friendship works. You have to just be good company first. Be there for someone first. You know, and Allah, when you do that for people, then Allah softens people's heart. So when the time is right, you can slip in some good advice. When the time is right, you can say, hey, you want to go grab some ice cream? Let's go. Hey, on the way, can we stop by from Bahrain? I got to pray. You could do that. But you have to be a little more strategic than just blatantly and constantly trying to, hey, have you watched the video I emailed you? Did you watch the whole thing? Don't do that. Just because you're interested doesn't mean your friend is. It's not the same. Now, is this a small subject in Allah's book? The second thing I want to talk to you about is actually that this is friendship is a pretty big deal in the Qur'an. I was actually myself shocked at how big a deal it is in the Qur'an, how huge a subject it is. There are at least 10 words in the Qur'an used for different kinds of friends. 10 different terms. And each of them talked about it extensively. Each of them has its own, you know, nuances and how Allah brings it up in different ayat. So one of the things I want to do with you tonight, inshallah, is kind of walk you through some of those terms and how Allah uses them in the Qur'an, at least one or two ayat for each. You know, what does Allah have to say about these kinds of friends? And the first of them is wali. Item number one, how many friends did I say? How many kinds of friends? Who remembers? 10. Good. Call it out. Be loud. It's okay. I know you're not used to that, but I'm from America. So it's all right. I need to know that you're alive and awake and not on Facebook. So the way I know that is if you're loud when I ask you a question. So don't feel like, astaghfirullah, I'm in a masjid, I cannot answer any questions. No. Just do istighfar if I ask you questions, if they look down ashamed. No, don't do that. Just call it out. And you don't have to raise your hand. You can just call it out. Okay? Now, the first kind of friend was what again? That's how loud you guys get? Really? Guys, I heard sisters, I didn't hear any brothers. What was the first kind of friend? Wali. Wali in the Arabic language is argued to be from mu'alat, which is a kind of protection. Someone who takes care of your matters. A friend that is there to, in some sense, when trouble comes, they can guard you. They can handle your situation. You know, so a strong friend also you could call a wali. And of course, wali has other implications. Like in marriage, you have to have a wali. It's a different terminology. Allah Azza wa Jal, one of his names is wali. Allahu waliyul ladina amanu. Allah is the wali of those who believe. He's a protective friend to those who believe. But one ayah that I want to highlight about the word wali is about when exactly the first theme I talked to you about. When you're trying to convey the message of Islam to somebody. فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Even if between you and somebody else there's animosity, you're talking to them and they're talking back to you with the most aggressive language. When I give the same dars in America, I talk about, well, if you're talking to a non-Muslim about Islam and they get aggressive, they start insulting Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or they start making fun of the Quran. It happens. It happens when you're just talking to people and, you know, about Islam. And even if they find out you're Muslim, some of them are really, the poison that they have been fed is so much that it just comes out in natural conversation for them. Right? And what are you supposed to do at that point? Anybody here know Brother Eddie from the Deen Show? Have you ever seen that before? You know, the Deen Show, this brother is an incredible human being. This guy is like a da'wah machine. He's constantly thinking about how do I tell somebody about Islam. So when I've only gone to Chicago twice to meet him. All the recordings that I've done with him are like in 1 day or 2 days. We just sit an entire day and do recordings. And he makes me change my jacket so it feels like it was a different visit. You know, so when we went to one of the public TV studios, we went into a TV studio to do a recording. And the cameraman was actually a very hardcore evangelical Christian. And is one of those evangelical Christians who has attended a few sermons about how to develop answers for Muslims and accusations against Muslims. So this old gentleman, he's 70, 75 years old. We're done with the recording, he calls Brother Eddie and me over and he starts saying the most horrible things about Rasulullah. Terrible, terrible things. And now what are you going to hear things like that and be like, would you say? And you know, and if we do that, if we get aggressive towards him and start making fun of the Bible or start saying, well, what do you know anyway? You people are this way or that way and you kufar, you etc. You know what? If that happens, then we've played into the hands of shaitan. That's what we've done. Let him say the most horrendous, horrible things and at the end of it all, you're like, you know what? Literally we say, you want to go grab some coffee. You want to go grab some coffee and get some donuts? I heard there's a good donut shop around the corner. But you know, your prophet this and your prophet that. I was like, hey, yeah. But I like you. Let's talk. You know, I want to hear more from you. Tell me more. Instead of responding to him. Just, you have to disarm people first. Allah says in Quran, even if somebody comes to you as an enemy, act like he's looking out for you. You have that kind of confidence in them. And hameen comes from himma, which is like a fever. It's a fever, literally a fever, like extreme heat, you know? And this is, it describes the intimacy of friendship. When you're that close with someone, there's a heat in your friendship.
There's a closeness, an intimacy in your friendship. I'm not talking about it in the romantic sense. I'm talking about it in the sense of you feeling so strongly towards someone, it heats you up. That's the idea in the Arabic literary sense. You know, this is the idea of Hamim. And Hamim, by the way, is one of the other words for friend. A friend that when you're with them, you feel warm inside, you feel comfortable. That's called a Hamim. And you have to be like that towards someone who's aggressive towards you. Can you imagine? Before we move on from this one thing, I want to highlight, this is how you should be towards your cousin, your brother, your uncle. Because your family is the meanest to you. And they can be, and you can't get rid of them either. You know? So they'll say the most horrible things to you, and they will say them over and over again. And you know what? You can't say, like we used to do back in the day, kutti. No longer your friend. You can't do kutti with your cousin. It's not possible. You know, they're still your cousin. They're still your family. They deserve that you grow a thick skin. They deserve that you learn to take it and not respond in a reactionary way. You know, this is really the beauty of Islam. That we are able to bear with patience around people that are very outrageous, obnoxious. That's the first kind of friend. The second kind of friend is a sadiq. Oh boy, a sadiq. Sadiq comes from siddiq. Anybody know what siddiq means? Call it out. Huh? Truthfulness. Truthfulness is siddiq. And a sadiq is actually a genuine friend. What that means is you're friends with someone for no reason except a genuine intention. In other words, you're not friends with them because being friends with them will make you feel more popular at school. You're not friends with them because, you know, when you're friends with them, then others will think more highly of you. Or they're really rich and you'd like to get a ride home in their car. Or you're not friends with them for an agenda. You're not friends with them because you want to get a job, you know. You're not friends with them because they're really smart at school and you could use the help for homework. You know, not for any of those reasons. When your friendship has no strings attached, it's true and genuine. You are friends with them for who they are. Not the things they own, not the status they have, not the artificial and superficial stuff. But it's a genuine friendship despite all of those things. That is sadaqah, actually. True, genuine friendship. No matter what. And you know what? Whether you have a job or not, whether you're doing good in school or not, whether you're having a good day or a bad day, a sadiq is a sadiq. They're going to be there for you. They're going to be there for you. And that's one of the hardest things to have in life, by the way, is a sadiq. You can have people that you play sports with, it's easy. You guys can have friends that you play PlayStation with or whatever, it's easy. It's not hard. You can have friends out, you know, you guys have some pretty intense sports during your break in school under the hot sun, and you know, the guys playing like volleyball and cricket and all that stuff in the heat. And you can make friends like that. That's easy. You can go have friends and go watch a movie together or whatever you do, you know, or hang out in the mall, you know. That's easy. But having a genuine friend that is there for you, whether you own a car or not, whether you have the money to pay for the food or not, you know. And even a friend that when you are doing well in your deen, they're your friend. And when you start making mistakes, you're still there. They're still there for you. Man, that's a real friend. They don't give up on you because you're not righteous anymore. And that's the kind of friend you have to be. I'm not talking about the friends you shouldn't be looking for. Remember that. This is a conversation about what kind of friend should I be and what kind of friend should you be. You know? I have to go out of my way. My high school friends, they're not like me. They're in a different world. You know, we went different ways, and a lot of my high school friends are non-Muslims. But I try to stay in touch with them as best I can. Because they're my friends. And we'll come to that later. Can you have friends that are non-Muslims? We'll get to that part. Is that even possible? Yes, it is possible. Yes, it is possible. And the ayat that are there, we have to understand them properly. We unnecessarily make the worldview of Islam overly aggressive, overly angry, and we fuse our own frustrations into it, and it just hurts our vision of the deen. It really does. So that's true of non-Muslims. We'll get to that in more detail a little later, but your Muslim friends that have fallen off, that you don't see at the masjid anymore, guys. You come and then you don't see them anymore. Call them. Don't say, well, you know, he's got different friends now, he does all kinds of bad things, I should forget it, I don't want to talk to him. Last time I talked to him, he said all this kind of stuff. No, let it go. Don't give up on your friends. And one of the greatest things about friendship is an Arabic wisdom actually. Sadiquka man sadaqak, la man sadaqak, right? Your friend is someone who's true to you, who's honest with you, not just someone who befriends you, not just someone who's friendly with you. In other words, when you're falling off, they're true to you and say, listen, I care about you. I don't want you to do this. I want to help you. And whatever it takes, you are honest with your friends. And sometimes you have friends around you that are all fake. They're all fake. And you do the wrong thing and they encourage you. And they're afraid to say something, because if they say something to you or you say something to them, the friendship might come to an end. So I don't want to say anything because they get really upset. You don't know my friend, they get really angry, you know? So I can't say anything. But that's your friend, man. Look at what he's doing. Look at how he talks to his mother. You should say something. No, bro, you don't know, man. That's how he talks to his mother. You don't know, he gets really angry. He makes the Hulk look calm, you know? I can't talk to him. No, don't do that. On the one hand, don't be judgmental to your friends. And on the other hand, don't be deceivingly just friendly no matter what. You can be friendly and honest at the same time with your friends. And that's a condition of friendship. And this is one of the things that people on Judgment Day that are on the wrong side of Judgment Day. They're heading towards hellfire. They're heading towards Allah's judgment and justice. May Allah not make us from them. Allah says about them in the Qur'an, وَمَا أَضَلَّنَا إِلَّا الْمُجْرِمُونَ. Nobody misguided us except the criminals. So they're saying that it's not our fault we're going to hell. It's not our fault we're in trouble on Judgment Day. It's criminals that misled us. Bad people misled us. Now who are these people? فَمَا لَنَا مِنْ شَافِعِينَ. We got nobody to make a case for us. Now a shafi' is someone who likes you, and when you're getting in trouble, they stand in the way and say, no. He's good, he's okay. Like imagine you're in trouble with the principal and the teacher comes in and says, he's a good student, I'll take care of it. He comes in the way. That's shafa'a. They say, today nobody's coming to back us up. Nobody's got our back today. And then they say, وَلَا صَدِيقٍ حَمِيمٍ. Sadiq is the only time this word is used directly like that in the Qur'an. They say today, we have no true friends that are close to us, that are showing us love. No loving true friends. SubhanAllah, you know what Allah is saying? The converse is also true. The people on the wrong side of Judgment Day will complain, we have no true friends today. And the people on the right side of Judgment Day will actually be on the opposite end. And they will have the shafa'a of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah qualify all of us for them. And they will have genuine friends. They'll have friends that were true to them here and then. And that's the other thing about this. Why do you lose friends? You lose friends sometimes because you're honest. You're truthful. You just say the right thing and they don't want to hear that. They don't want to hear that. And you know what? They can distance themselves, but that doesn't mean you give up on them. You come back to them and you still remain truthful. So friendships can be painful in this world. They can be painful in this world, but you still don't give up on them. And then they become eternal friendships in the Akhirah. They become gatherings of like constant and permanent happiness, subhanAllah. So that's the second. So we've talked about wali and we've talked about sadiq. And then on the side, I kind of also talked to you about hamim. And there's sahib. Sahib is a very comprehensive word in the Quran for friend. And sahib could be used in the most casual sense for people that you are even sitting next to on a train or on a journey. Wasahibi bil jamb, for example. The guy sitting next to you, right by your side, you're traveling and you strike a friendship, he's your sahib. For those 5-6 hours on the ride or on the flight, that's your sahib. Right? So it could be some very casual acquaintance that can be sahib. But if you spend a lifetime with someone, they're also your sahib. But there's one thing universally in common for a sahib. And a sahib is someone who means well for you. They mean well for you. They want something good for you. They're looking out for you. So if there was a problem, they try to help in whatever capacity they can. Now the more they know you, the more they can help. The more genuinely concerned and courteous they're going to be. One of the names of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran is وَمَا صَاحِبُكُمْ بِمَجْنُونَ. They're talking to the Quraysh, your sahib is not insane at all. Why is he their sahib? Because he's had suhbah with them. He's spent a lot of time with them. He's been with them and he actually is concerned about them. He cares for them. He's not giving them a message to dominate them. He's giving them a message because it's good for them. You know, like Nuh alayhi salam, when he was warning his people, he said, "Inni lakum nadhirun mubin." I'm a clear warner for your sake. Lakum there, the taqdeem of it, is for ikhtisas and ihtimam, they say in Nahu in Arabic. The point of that is, I'm especially looking out for you, not for myself. That's why I'm giving you this message. That's a sahib. In the Quran, you've got, you know, the two gardeners in Surah Al-Kahf that have a conversation with each other. You know, إِذْ قَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ وَقَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ. They talk to each other and they're sahib to each other. That's the physical sense because they're neighbors. They're neighboring each other, you know. And one of them, you know, he thinks he's looking out for his friend, but he's not. He's actually pretty mean. And I just want to highlight that one aspect of the wrong kind of sahib before I move on. How can you think you're doing something nice, but you're mean? I'm going to be honest with you guys. I know, alhamdulillah, you guys aren't going to mind my brutal honesty. One of the things that's concerned me as I came here, and every nation has its concerns, every country has its concerns, and we have some universal concerns, but something unique that I found here, that I haven't seen in many other places, and it may be a phenomenon in the entire region, is that you guys are obsessed with over-the-top, super luxurious brands. Over-the-top. Like I saw a billboard for an Alfa Romeo. Like, or like a Porsche or something, or like a Rolex watch, or like, over-the-top. Oh my God. Like there's no normal commercials here. Nobody's like giving you a commercial for a toothbrush, or like a sneaker, or like a pair of socks or something. Everybody's like walking through a 7-star hotel and the water fountain's on their side and a hawk flies onto their arm and and they check their diamond and my God! You know, and you know what that does to a society? You become obsessed with elite brands. You become obsessed with the brand of watch you're wearing or the brand of shoes. You know, or maybe even the brand of jilbab, I don't know. You know? The brand of hijab, or where you're, and if you're, when you're shopping in the mall, which is supposed to be like a national sport, I think, right? So if you're shopping in the mall, make sure you go to the most expensive store and buy like the smallest thing, but get the biggest bag so you look like you're worth something, you know, like flaunting the bag. Like, I got an Armani bag, I'm gonna put in your face before it. You know what this does? This creates an artificial, like, fake society. That, and it creates these standards that nobody can live up to. Nobody actually looks like those commercials, by the way. That's not real. All that's fake. And people get so deluded by that. And then the people around them get deluded by that. If you're really going to be a sahib in this society, make being normal celebrated. Don't celebrate being over the top and posh and overly, you know, luxurious. Celebrate normalcy. Celebrate being yourself. It's something cool. You know, you don't have to be someone you're not. You don't have to live up to this fake standard of living that really nobody should be. Nobody should be. That should be their normal state. It's not sustainable. It's not healthy for you to want that for your life. That's not a goal to live by. And by the way, if that's your goal, like you're always going to be smiling and like checking your brand name watch and then flipping on the giant screen TV and overlooking the balcony of this amazing hotel, and jump into the swimming pool and all of that. If that's the life you're dreaming about, you're gonna live a miserable life. Maybe you'll get those things, and people who get those things are still miserable. Some of the richest counties in the United States have the highest suicide rates. They have everything. They have everything, and they have the highest suicide rates. How many like platinum musicians, artists from the United States, Hollywood actors are dying of drug overdoses? They're so depressed with reality that they want to drug themselves up so they don't have to face reality. And they're killing themselves over it. These are not people you want to be like. These are people you want to feel sorry for. You don't want to be like them, you know? It's unfortunate that an entire generation of Muslims all over the world is like going crazy over pathetic, sad cases like Justin Bieber. I feel sorry for the guy, honestly. Honestly, I feel sorry for him. He's a kid. And they've set him up to... They've put this, like, crazy world around him. And everybody, people are, like, crying and, like having spiritual experiences when he walks by and stuff. Like, why? Why? This is part of being sahib, being responsible citizens to your people. Setting a standard for what you should live up to. When you start not being so deluded by fashion, deluded by brands, and so deluded by the next material thing. Oh, I only have an iPhone 4, I can't be your friend. You have an iPhone 5. You know, like, You can't. You can't be like that. Don't stand in line like 300 people outside the iPhone Apple store when the iPhone 5S comes out. Don't be one of those people. It's okay. You will be able to... I promise you, oxygen will still be available. You'll still be able to breathe and live your life if you're not the first one to have it. You know? And about the people who buy it, guess what? They don't keep it in their pocket. I put it in front of them and then we'll musalla Allahu Akbar. So the guy next to him, 5S. Sami Allahu liman hamida. Like, come on. You know? So that's sahib. That's sahib. Don't be a show off. Don't be, and it's talked about in the ayat of Surah Al-Kahf. Today's not a dars on Surah Al-Kahf. Or those two people, I think somebody must have put that thing on YouTube. But I talked about the conversation between those two gardeners, and how it's a really insightful conversation about people that are super materialistic and like to make other people feel bad because of the things they own. Like they slip it in, yeah, this is just, it's a cheap bag, it's Gucci, but it's cheap, you know. It's just, it was on sale, 800, 1,000, you know. It's not a healthy way to live. And it's not something you want other people to feel. And it actually shows that you're not a concerned person for the rest of society. The next term, so we have wali, let's see if you remember any of them. Wali and what else? Sadiq and what else? Hamim, good memory. Hamim and what else? Sahib. So I want to talk to you a little bit about this other term, walija. Occurs once in the Quran, walija. Comes from the verb walaja. And walaja yaliju in Arabic means to enter, to penetrate deeply. Like Allah says, يَعْلَمُ مَا يَخْرُجُ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا. Right? He knows what goes into the earth and what comes out of it. So, walija in Arabic is a friend who is all up in your business. They know all about what's going on in your life. And they're deeply involved in your affairs. Like, you can trust them so much that you can share anything with them. And you don't just share with them, they're actually involved. They're involved. Now this is a very special kind of friendship. It's not a typical friendship. It's not someone you're nice to and hang out with and text back and forth, and even they're genuine to you and other things. This is a very close form of friendship and very rare to find nowadays. This is someone you can trust with your bank account. This is someone you can trust with your house. This is someone you can trust in any matter, and they can, like when you say, hey, I'm giving you my checkbook, because I'm traveling for a month or I'm going for Hajj or something like that, please write these checks out for my bills or whatever. And you don't have to think twice about it. You would not worry about it. That kind of friendship is extremely rare today. It's extremely rare. And what's interesting in the Quran is that Allah Azza wa Jalla made it a condition. He made it a condition that you can only have this kind of friend with a fellow believer. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تُتْرَكُوا. Have you assumed that you're going to be left alone? You think you're not going to go through any tests? وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ. You're coming. You sure? Okay, I got distracted. Okay. وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ. Allah hasn't yet discovered who among you really struggles. وَلَمْ يَتَّخِذْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلَا رَسُولِهِ وَلَا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلِيجًا. And He did not take anybody as a walija. Walija again, someone who's really deeply involved in every one of your matters. He didn't take anyone other than Allah and His Messenger and believers to go deep into their matters. Now what does that mean for us? What that means is Allah should be involved in every matter of my life. He's a walij to me. Allah is calling Himself that in this ayah. You and I will go through trials and Allah will test to see how deeply is Allah involved in your most important personal matters. What is His role in your family decisions? What is His role in the kind of financial decisions you make? The kind of business decisions you make? The kind of career and education decisions you make? What is His role? Is He a walij to you? You trust, or you have that kind of friendship with Allah or not? Then He added the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. How much do we consult the legacy of our Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the most personal matters of our life? When you and I are having trouble in marriage, how much do we consult the Prophet والسلام, and his example? When you and I are having trouble with friends, how much do we consult the advice of Rasulullah? How deeply involved is he in our most intimate matters? You see, when we talk about the sunnah of the Prophet والسلام, nowadays, we celebrate and we emphasize the most outwardly aspect. of the sunnah. So sunnah prayers before the fard prayer, the sunnah of keeping a beard, the sunnah of, you know, being the first to say salam, the sunnah of these mannerisms and these etiquette that we learn from our beloved messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But these are, in many aspects, they're still public and outwardly. But the most intimate matters of yours, the most internal matters, like, should I get into this financial transaction? Should I buy these clothes at this price or not? You know, should I go with my friends and do this thing that they're all doing? Should I just go with them? Have I involved the messenger in those? Where's the sunnah in that? Even in the way you talk, even though in the way you carry yourself. And this is a big problem in the ummah, and I don't judge you. I'm not saying Bahraini people have special problems. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying this is a problem across the ummah. The way we talk to each other is so messed up. There's no sunnah in it. There's no sunnah of the respect for the elder. There's no, we're not following that.